The Dido, or Dido-class light cruisers of the Royal Navy, shared a surprising common history with the Tribal-class destroyers, both originating from the same conceptual design in the mid-1930s. This design had arisen as a result of the need for a small trade protection cruiser, with the current design, the Arethusa class, being considered to have too few main guns, as it only carried 6 6-inch guns in 3 twin turrets. As the class was supposed to be small, that meant the caliber of the guns had to be stepped down in order to achieve the requisite numbers. The design developed had called for a ship with 5 twin 4.7-inch gun mounts. With one mount shaved off, this design went off to become the Tribal's, but with these 5 mounts upgraded to the new 5.25-inch twin turret, the design would also become the Dido's. The idea was for the cruisers to serve as anti-aircraft escorts for the fleet in times of war, as well as trade protection duties, so their role profile was similar to the Atlantas, with a bit more colonialism thrown in. As a result, parts and ammunition commonality was sought, and the ships were to be given the same 5.25-inch twin turret as was currently being mounted for secondary armament on the King George V class battleships. The main battery was to consist of 10 5.25-inch guns in the aforementioned twin turrets, 3 of them stacking in the front in an ABC double superfiring position, and the remaining 2 X and Y turrets in a superfiring pair aft. The anti-aircraft firepower of the ship was supplemented somewhat questionably by a pair of quad 50 caliber machine guns, and somewhat more usefully by a pair of quad 40mm quick-firing pom-pom mounts. Additional anti-surface firepower was provided in the shape of 2 triple torpedo tubes, one on each side. With around 62,000 shaft horsepower on tap, driving 4 propellers, the ships could make a rather comfortable 32 knots and change. In the event, displacement would vary somewhat, with standard displacement of between 5,700 and 5,900 tons, and a full load that varied from just under 7,000 tons to just over 7,500 tons, depending on how the ships were configured. However, with the ships being laid down between the end of 1937 and 1939, they were still either under construction or being fitted out when World War II broke out. This led to a rather urgent need for their services, but the twin 5.25-inch turret had proven rather difficult to manufacture, and in any case, as with many other British turrets built at the time, had a number of flaws which required correction. As a result, whilst some ships would complete with their full 5-turret armament, a number of others would complete with only 4 of their 5.25-inch turrets, with the missing one being replaced by a 4-inch star shell gun. The exact position of this gun varied depending on which ship we're talking about. In the confusion of war, some of the ships that had completed with 4 turrets would later receive a 5th turret, and other ships that had completed with 5 turrets would have the 5th turret removed and replaced by something else. The shortage of 5.25-inch guns had gotten so acute, but the need for the cruisers so desperate, that HMS Scylla and HMS Charybdis were actually completed with 4 twin 4.5-inch turrets instead. Originally devised as a dual-purpose weapon mount for refitted Royal Navy battleships and the Royal Navy's new carriers, this particular turret may initially have appeared to give the ships much less firepower, but when you're talking about a twin 4.5-inch mount, i.e. something that's more suited to a destroyer or a secondary battery, being given the full range of fire control systems, shell supply, etc., that was designed for a turret mount that was considerably larger, they proved to be quite the terrifying prospect, able to spit out shells at an almost unbelievable rate, thanks in part to the fact that the 4.5-inch gun was just small enough that the shell and cartridge came together as one unit, which made loading a lot quicker and easier. As the war went on, the ships rapidly lost their quad machine gun mounts and a whole variety of 20mm Oerlikon, 40mm Bofors and 40mm pom-poms began to proliferate across all of the ships, in various configurations. Taking the lessons of the first run of ships to heart, the Bellona subclass was slightly different. They, as designed, only carried 4 5.25-inch twin turrets, but these were the RP-10 Mark II turrets, with remote power training and elevation, which made them considerably more lethal. With the weight saved from losing one of the turrets, they were also able to carry 3 quadruple 40mm pom-pom mounts and 12 20mm Oerlikon cannons. A cut-down superstructure also meant that weight was available for these ships to be fitted with full radar fire control for both the 5.25-inch and 40mm guns, which gave them a rather ferocious anti-aircraft barrage. The class operated mostly in the Mediterranean and Pacific, although they did do stints in the home fleet and on Arctic escort duty as well. 5 of the ships were lost: Bonaventure, Charybdis, Hermione, Nade, and Spartan. Additionally, Scylla was badly damaged by a mine, and although it made it home, it wasn't worth repairing. Thanks to their anti-aircraft focus, the class survived a surprisingly long time in the post-war environment, with Bellona, Black Prince, and Royalist being lent to the Royal New Zealand Navy, and Diadem sold to Pakistan. Most of the Royal Navy's ships would be decommissioned in the late 1950s, but the New Zealand ships would last into the 1960s, and the ex-Diadem was actually still in service with the Pakistani Navy in 1985. It must be said that although the 5.25-inch twin turret did have its problems at the start, once they were fixed, these ships proved remarkably capable in combat, shooting down quite a number of Axis aircraft and scaring off far more. Their ability to lay down a heavy anti-aircraft barrage of combined heavy, medium and light AA put them on a par with the Atlantas of the US Navy, with the latter ships being able to sustain a slightly greater rate of fire with their more numerous guns, but the heavier shell of the 5.25 proving slightly more lethal on an individual basis.
That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you have a comment or suggestion for a ship to review, let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to comment on the pinned post for dry dock questions.